I think we are good to go. Any question first about SP or else? No? Okay. So today we will talk about what is certainly one of my favorite topics, community detection, which can also be called graph clustering. So we can call it graph clustering. So community detection is equivalent to clustering for unstructured data. So maybe you have done some machine learning or something else you might know about clustering. The idea of clustering is to find groups of elements that are similar in a set of items. So for instance, you could take apartments based on characteristics. So for apartments, you have a number of rooms, the size of the apartment, the number of windows, and whatever. And you want to find groups of apartments that are similar. This is clustering. And it's a very popular topic. There are hundreds of methods published on this topic since the 50s. The most famous algorithm is the K-means, that some of you probably know. And the big problem of this kind of approach is to define what similar to each other means. Okay, so a good example of that is to use these toy examples, and to so each dot of this of a figure corresponds to one item, where with two attributes x and y, and they are plotted according to this to x and y, and you see that on each row there is a different problem to solve. Find groups. And some of them are very entity clear. So here we can see that we want to find three groups, but in some cases it's more difficult. Here, maybe we want to find three groups. Here you have some circles. So should you find two or more? So that's also the problem of defining what are good groups in data. And what you see with these examples, so each column here corresponds to one algorithm. And you see that they make different decisions. So basically, when the problem is very clearly defined, like this rule, every algorithm agrees that you should find three groups. But if the problem is, for instance, random, so here you have just random dots everywhere, then some algorithm will tell you that there are no groups. Some of them might tell you there are three groups, and they try to split the space in three. Some might decide that there are four groups, and so on and so forth. And when the problem is complex, like this one or this one, you see that you have very different results. So in this case, if you're based on some local decisions, you might consider that this is a group, and this is another group, because you can move from this dot to this dot by going through neighbors. While for this algorithm, for instance, you will have two groups because, or maybe this one has four groups because here you will have kind of one group here and all the dots in this group are relatively close in space, while in those groups they are close between them but different, far from your dots. And to give you a better sense of what is going on, you have even this example where you see that, for instance, if you make this decision, three groups, these two dots, which are very close to each other in the space, so they are very similar value of x, very similar value of y, but you put them in different groups. While and if you look at the global picture, it seems to make sense to have this. So this is just to introduce the notion that making groups with data is very complex, and it depends on what you're searching for. There is no one good solution. Okay, so this was clustering on data with properties, so not on graphs. And this problem can be transferred in graphs by community detection, and which is loosely defined as searching for groups of nodes which are strongly connected to each other and more weakly connected to the rest of the graph. So this is the original definition of communities. It's a parallel with community in social networks. You can imagine that some group of people tend to stay together and have less connection with the rest of the society. And yeah, so you have an example here with three groups, which seems to make sense. But again, you could make different splits in if the situation is not as clear. And that's a problem. It's that there is no formal definition of what are good communities. So many people have worked on this topic, and hundreds of methods have been published in recent years. So why should we look for communities in real data? One of the reasons is that if you remember in the previous classes, we defined random models, and we have found that real networks, they tend to have a high clustering coefficient, but random networks, they don't have a high clustering coefficient. And we have seen that when the network grows large, when a random network becomes large, the clustering coefficient is vanishing, going very close to zero. But if the network is small, if you generate a small network, then it's a small random networks, they can have a high clustering coefficient. So one of the ideas of communities is that you could see your network, maybe, as a set of small random networks. So you have a lot of small random networks that are connected by some random edges, for instance. So small random network, they can have a high clustering coefficient. And so if you have a collection of small networks, since the clustering coefficient is a local measure, a sum of small network will have a high clustering coefficient. And then the random edges between them will allow to have a short path, for instance. So this means that it kind of defines a random network that has good properties because it has a high clustering coefficient. So this is one explanation. Yeah, and the other explanation is that real networks tend to effectively have this kind of structure. If, for instance, if you take a social network, so this is a social network plotted of someone, I don't know if it's LinkedIn or Facebook, but every dot corresponds to a friend of someone. For someone, you take its ego network, so all its friends. All friends, and you add an edge between them if they are friends. And you see that clearly this network is formed of groups. You have one group here, one group there, yellow, blue, and so on and so forth. And you see that they tend to be strongly connected to each other, more weakly connected to the rest of the graph. Which makes sense if you think about your own personal network. Probably you have some friend from high school, for instance, that they know each other, but they don't know much about people from your family. People from your family, they tend to know each other, but not people from high school. And then you have maybe the group of people from the complex system master that maybe you know them, they know each other, but they don't know your friend from high school or your family. So it makes sense to see this organization in groups. But it's not only for social network. If you look at the brain, you can find also some structure like this with some areas of the brain in which there are a lot of synchronization and which are much more poorly synchronized to other regions of the brain. If you look to geographical organization, for instance, here it's in Belgium, you have it represents a network in which nodes are antennas of cell phones, and edges correspond to the number of communications between antennas. And if you apply a commutation algorithm on this network, you will get some splitting of the space like this, where colors correspond to the communities discovered by an algorithm, and the black lines correspond to administrative regions. Okay, and what you can observe is that they are quite similar. So if the community detection is able to discover something which corresponds to some real administrative regions, and if you try to find communities at a higher level, you will discover in the same data set only two communities, and probably you can guess what these communities represent. They represent language in Belgium, so you have this this known division in language, and you can discover this by studying this network using community detection. So where does the problem of community detection comes from? It was actually initially a problem of graph theory called the graph partitioning problem, in which you try to cut your network in k parts of approximately the same size. You decide what is k, and you want to find the groups that minimize the number of links between the groups. Okay, so this is a very well-defined problem, but it's not community detection because it's they say that it's an objective called graph partitioning. But the problem here is that you need to define the number of clusters, and you need to define that the clusters have the same size. So some relaxation exists, like maybe if it's not exactly the same size, or if the number of parts is not exactly k, so you can relax it. But you still need to keep this constraint, because if you remove this constraint, then the best solution to have very few edges between parts is to make one part which has all the network, and then another node which is just alone, and you pick the node that has only one edge, for instance, a node with very small degree. And then, since you have everything in one block and a node with only one connection in the other, then naturally you have only one edge between the two parts. Okay, so it's not an interesting answer to the question. So that's why you have to put some limits to the size of groups and the number of groups. And so in 2002, in a paper by Gavin and Newman, they introduced the problem of community discovery. That's how they introduced it, because they made the parallel with social networks. They made the observation that usually when you have to understand, if someone gives you a graph, you don't know the number of blocks, you don't know the size of blocks. So they wanted to propose an algorithm that can discover groups that make sense, and the number of groups and the size of the groups. Okay, so the algorithm proposed was very simple. You already know all the elements to understand it. First, what you do is to compute the betweenness. You compute the betweenness for the edges. And if you remember, the betweenness measure how much an edge is a bridge, right? You're computing how important it is to keep the network connected, basically. So you compute the edges with the highest betweenness, and then you remove the edge of highest betweenness. So what you're trying to do is actually to split the network apart. Okay. That's a simple idea. And then you repeat this process until all edges have been removed. And what you keep track is every time you separate your graph in connected components, components that are not connected anymore, right? On a separate connected components. So this is called a divisive method, because you start with a single group, and then you will remove edge until you get two groups, then three groups, four groups, and so on and so forth. So you divise your method, and what you obtain is something like this, a dendrogram. So this is a hierarchical method, where in the beginning you have a single group, then you get two groups, then you get three groups. Yeah, then you have four groups, and so on and so forth. So you can choose the number of groups that you want, and you get an answer at this level. But this was not really new, because in clustering it's already known, these kind of approaches. But what actually they introduced is a new criterion to choose where to cut the tree. So you don't have anymore to choose the number of clusters that you want. They introduce a function to choose that you should cut maybe here, because it's the level with the maximal modularity score. And so what I introduced is the modularity. So the modularity is computed for a partition of a graph. So I give you a graph, and I give you a partition of this graph, of the node of this graph. So a partition means that each node must belong to one and only one community. Okay, each node belongs to one and only one community. I give you this partition, the graph, and you can compute the modularity. And the modularity is very simply defined. Again, you have all the tools to understand it. You have to compare the observed fraction of edges inside community. So among all edges, you take the ones which are inside the community. So the more edges inside, the better. And you will compare that to the expected fraction of edge inside community if the network was random. And if the network was random, using usually the configuration model. Okay, so the configuration model will keep the degrees. So you keep the degree, you know the degree of nodes inside the cluster. You compute this random network. You count how many edges are expected inside the community. And you compare this with the real number. And if the communities are well chosen, if the partition is well chosen, you will have more edges inside the cluster than you would expect at random. So this is very simply translated into this formula, where you sum over all pairs of nodes with a Kronecker delta, which is one if both of them are in the same community. And this is equal to one if there is an edge between the two nodes. And this, you might recognize it from the configuration model. This is exactly the probability, or this little bit incorrect probability, of having an edge between two nodes depending on the degree. Okay, so basically for all the this removes when there is no edge, when they are not in the same community. So for each pair of nodes, which is in which each pair of nodes where both nodes are in the same community, and you add one by this, so you count the number of edge inside community, and by this you remove the number of edges that you have to expect if the network was random. Okay, counting the edges, removing what is expected. So this was the original formulation. There is another one, so you can take later, but when you can define by community. So this is actually summing for each community the number of edge inside the community minus the expected number of edge inside this community. And because you can define it as a sum by community, this simplifies the computation because you can compute it locally. Yes. Here?
Yes,
A. Yeah, A is the adjacency matrix. Okay. Yes, so A U V A V W, sorry, means that since it's an adjacency matrix, there is a one if there is an edge, there is zero if it's not an edge. Yes. In the first formula, so sometimes it's N, sometimes it's big L, but it's the same thing. There are two notations. Yeah. And you see other one. Yes.
It's also involved in thoughts to contribute on the graph. What did the minister we do?
Yeah. So here it's the configuration model. It's the version that keep the degrees. Actually, what's happening here is that we are not generating any random network for real. We are just comparing with the expected value. So if I were generating many, many networks, an infinity of networks, using the configuration model, then I would expect to have exactly this number of edges between these two nodes. So this can be, for instance, let's say 0.8. So this means that if I generate many networks with the configuration model, in average, I will have 0.8 edges between these two nodes. And if it's here, it's one, then you see that you will have one, there is an edge, 0.8, I expect to have an edge, but not. I'm not sure. So it's positive because I have an edge while I was not expecting completely one, but of course, if this is very small, if here you have something close to zero, then you have it's even more positive. If you have, so this is just counting the number of edges that you expect inside the community, because you. Yeah, this I think I'm making things less clear by saying that, but if you forget about this part for now, you're just computing for all the pairs of nodes that are inside communities. You're computing the sum of this value. And this gives you the number of edge that you expect to have inside community. Okay? So we can discuss in detail later if it's not clear, or if there are other people for who it's not clear, I can try to explain better, but maybe it needs a picture to go in detail. Yes, so your question was actually interesting because you asked to which network should I compare. And what I introduced, it's the original definition. We compare to the configuration model, the one where we keep the degrees. But there are other possibilities. The idea of this mode, of this definition of this quality function, the modularity, is really to compare your network with a new model. And choose the new model which is the most appropriate for you. So, for instance, you could use an adversary new model if you think that the degree are not meaningful in your graph. Or you could use, so I did not add it here, but for instance, there are some methods that propose to replace it by something we haven't seen yet, which is a special new model that take into account distance between nodes. Physical distance, spatial distance, and you can use this model to remove the effect of space, for instance, of distance. But okay, just remember that you can choose the new change the new model to one which is appropriate. It can be naturally extended to weighted or multi-edge networks, right? Because you, instead of counting the edges, you will count the weight of the edge. You want to have many edges, and you want to have these edges, the edge with a high weight inside the communities. Okay. So the algorithm of German and Newman that I introduced was doing something intuitively good, but in fact not direct, because they choose a method based on between S to fit the graph. And then they use the criterion, they introduce modularity to choose the right level. But then people realized that, in fact, what you wanted to find, what you should try to find is the partition with the highest modularity, because you're using your modularity as a criteria of good communities. So many methods were proposed following this to optimize directly the modularity. So let's find among all the possible partition of a graph, the partition of highest modularity. So many methods were proposed based on graph spectral approaches, based on meta-heuristic, and so on and so forth. And in 2008, a method was proposed, which is known nowadays as the Louvain algorithm. And this algorithm is, to this day, probably the most popular method. So if you, for instance, the one in Jeffy, it's the Louvain algorithm. And in many papers outside of network science, if someone use community detection, they use either the original method by Gavin and Newman or the Louvain algorithm. It's one of the reasons why it's so popular is because it's fast and it's easy to implement. But mainly it's fast, so you can apply it on very large graph. And when it was introduced, it was beating the state of the art, of course. So here you have the algorithm in an informal manner. But if you're interested, you can go through all the detail. I will just explain it to you intuitively. The idea is very simple. It's a greedy algorithm. So there is nothing very, very complex in it. It's just that you will try to move. So you start with every node in its own community. Okay. Here, each node is in its own community. And then you will loop through all the nodes. And for each node, you try to move it to the community of one of its neighbors. Okay. So you take this node, for instance, I don't know, this node. And for all the neighbors, you try to move it in the community of this neighbor. So maybe you try to move it to the green community or to the pink community. And in both cases, you check how much it improves modularity. Okay, very simple. If it improves and then for this node, among all the possibilities, you choose the one improving the modularity the most, because you want to improve the modularity. You want to maximize the modularity. So you do this for all nodes. Okay, so all nodes, so you see the complexity is n, and then you start again, you do exactly the same process, you take all nodes again, and you try to move to the neighbors, n again, and then you do it again and again, until you reach a point where you cannot increase modularity anymore. And you have some criteria that you decrease, so at first you need to increase, at first if you increase just a little bit the modularity, you don't pick these possibilities just so to force the comparator. Okay. So you do this process until you reach, and you will reach maybe this solution. And the second step is that you will create what we call an end-used graph or aggregated graph like this. We go to a certain level in which communities become nodes. So you create a new graph. And this node represents all these communities. And then this node corresponds all nodes in this community, and this node corresponds to all nodes in this community. So you create this end-used graph, and you add edges between them corresponding to the number of links between the nodes of these clusters. And you see that, for instance, the let's call it green, or gray, I don't know, this gray community has no link to the red one, okay? So here you have no link between these two clusters. And the weight here corresponds to the number of edges that you have. So you create this higher level network, and then what you do is applying again the same process that you had here. So you again move your nodes until reaching a stable situation, you create an end-use network, and you continue. You continue until reaching the global modularity maximum. So there is no guarantee that you will reach the maximum modularity, but you usually get a very good approximation, so a good solution. Okay, that's Louvain method, yes. Why is it low? You're counting internal edges. And if you have each node in its own community, you have zero internal edges. You count the number of edges inside community.
The modularity is zero?
So it's zero. And the modularity is actually between between minus one and one. Yeah. So if it's one, it's maximal. If it's zero, it means that it's like if it were random. No better than random. So if you put everything in one, in every node in its own community, it's not better than random. If you put everything in one community, it's not better than random. So you need to find some solution which is in between. In the definition here, you have this. This is the Kronecker delta, and it tells you that if the community of B and the community of W is the same, if both are the same, this equals one. Otherwise, it equals zero. So this means that for all the nodes that are not in the same community, this is zero. So you multiply this by zero, so you get zero. You don't count them. Okay? And in this definition, you see also that for each community, going from for each of the community, you count the number of links inside the community. Another question on Google. So you see, it's a very simple method. The main innovation compared to what was existing before was the optimization of computing this higher level network, and to compute locally the gain in modularity, because they realized that the modularity could be expressed as a sum of value by community. We could improve it locally. Okay, so we have seen that we have a very good algorithm to maximize the modularity. But so maybe you could say at this point the problem is solved. We just have to keep this method and maybe to improve a little bit on it, and that's it. But then at about the same time when the Louvain algorithm was proposed, some people realized that there was a problem with modularity. That actually modularity is not a definition of what are good communities. It's just a score that has been introduced, and which is meaningful because you see that your part, if it's a positive value, you have more edges than expected, so it tells you something, but it's not a definition. And people realized that in a paper where they introduced what they call the resolution limit of modularity. A good example to understand the problem very clearly is with this example of the what they call a ring click network, in which you have clicks of nodes, so nodes that are all connected to each other, that are connected by single edges like this. So you have this, and you can add more clicks if you want. Then you can make the circle bigger by adding new clicks. And what they observed is that, so what you expect to find, according to the definition of communities at the beginning, even if it was not a formal definition, clearly what you expect to find is that each click should be a community, right? Because it's very dense inside, density of one, and it has very few connections to outside. So it really clearly corresponds to our definition. But what you actually observe, so you maybe don't see it on because of the light, but the communities that you find with optimizing modularity is pairs of clicks. So this is a community. This is a community. This is another community, and so on and so forth. Okay, so each community is a pair of, and this is not a problem of the algorithm. It's really the solution of maximal modularity on this network. Yeah, so clearly it's a problem. If you keep a small number of clicks, it works. Each click is found as one community. But then if you increase to a large number of clicks, then you find that the modularity will want to merge these clicks together. So it was a discovery that modularity has a favorite, kind of a favorite scale. And what it means is that if you have a network with a given size and a given density, then you can find only communities of a certain size. So you cannot find small communities in large graph. Or large communities in small network. Okay, so I don't go into the details, but of course there is a reference in the cheat sheets if you're interested, or even, So one solution proposed to solve this problem was to introduce a resolution parameter, which basically, so if you, the key of the modularity is that you compare for each community the number of edges inside to the number of edges expected. And what this multi-resolution method proposes is to add some lambda here, which is a parameter that you choose. If it's one, you have the usual modularity. If you choose another value, smaller or bigger, you will shift your resolution to smaller or larger graph. So if you have a small value here, you will find smaller groups. And if you have a large value, you will find larger groups. And So this is kind of a solution, but you see also that it's more a patch than a solution. There is no good theoretical ID behind it, just that you try to impose this to find smaller or larger communities. So modularity has other weaknesses. The most important one I want to point here is that you will discover communities even in random networks. So if you generate a random network with your favorite model, and you search for the solution of optimal modularity, then you will find a solution that has a positive modularity and that can even have a high score of modularity in a large graph. Why? Because you will fit on some random fluctuations. So because you're searching the partition that has the highest modularity, you will find one by just overfitting on the random variation. Nevertheless, Louvain and modularity remains to this day the most popular approaches, although recently there are some new approaches that gain popularity. And so you maybe in 5 years or 10 years, I won't introduce Louvain anymore, but maybe the Leiden instead of the Louvain method. Anyway, nowadays, so this topic is still very popular. There were really thousands of algorithms published until now, and every conference on complex networks, you have at least one person proposing a new algorithm, and often more than one. So it's still a popular topic. The problem is that it's very easy to, well, people not really compare to what exists in the state of the art on the 1,000 previous algorithm. They usually only compare to Louvain and say that their algorithm is better on one example, and then try to publish the paper. So so this is a common problem. And there is a debate a little bit in the community. In the field of network science, with people saying that no algorithm is better than other. It depends on the type of network, or it depends on your objective, which is true for one part. But I also think that there is something more than that in communities, and you can really define a better definition. We could find a better definition of what are good communities. So to give you some examples, I will more quickly introduce two different approaches that are theoretically grounded. So it's not just a random algorithm, but just a simple algorithm trying to optimize the modularity. They have a different definition of what are good communities, and I think they are interesting. So the first one is called InfoMap. It was introduced by Rosbaud and Bergstrom in 2009, but they introduced a lot of new versions to discover hierarchical communities, communities in dynamic networks, and so on and so forth. So it's an actively researched approach. And it's defined as an information theoretic approach in which you try to minimize the cost, the number of bits that you need, that you need to minimize the description of a random walk on a network. And this is easy to understand with a picture. So it's a picture from the article where they explain the method. Basically, you have, this is a random walk on a network. So this is, you have your network, and this spaghetti here represents one instance of a random walk, where you start here, and then you pick one of the neighbors, and you move to this neighbor, for instance, this one. Then you pick one of the neighbors, and maybe you move to this one, then maybe you move to this one, then to this node, and maybe you move again to this one, and you follow this spaghetti, which is just one instance of a random. And in this example, we show that if we want to describe this random walk, you can do it by assigning a unique ID to each node. So a sequence of zeros and one that describe this node. Okay, and so if I want to describe the random walk, I just have to write the description. So the first one is this sequence this sequence of bits. So I here put this sequence of bits. Then the second one is this one, 1100. So I will write 1100. And then I move to the one in the bottom. So it's 11011. So I will have to run 11011 and so on and so forth. So this is just a description of the random walk by stacking together the code of the node. And I choose, of course, the code which are the most efficient to do that, the shortest possible description of the node. And what I'm interested in is the length of this description. How many bytes I need to code this? How many I need? And the question is, so the idea of InfoMap is that if I define proper communities, I should be able to encode more efficiently this description. What I will do is that I will assign a code for a community. So I need to code to describe that I'm inside this community. And then I will use other codes to describe the nodes inside the community. And this allows me to say that I need only when I move inside the community, I need to use only once the code saying that I'm in this community. And then I have only to describe the shorter description of this node inside this community. So of course it's shorter than these codes because this one needs to describe, to identify the node among all nodes. While here you need to identify the node among only the nodes inside the community. So you have something shorter. And the idea is that if you stay long enough inside the cluster, then you can use this short description. So it's longer when I have to move to another cluster. If I move to another cluster, you will need a little bit more bits to describe it because you need to now to first describe that I'm moving out of this cluster, I'm moving in the other one. And then I have to describe the node I'm in this cluster. So you make moving between cluster a little bit more costly, but moving inside cluster a little bit less costly. And the idea of finding good clusters is that inside the community, you should be trapped, kind of trapped in the community. And we see it because a community by definition is dense and is weakly connected to the rest of the graph. So since it's weakly connected to the rest of the graph, you have a low probability to move to another cluster. And since it's strongly connected inside, you have a higher probability to move to one of the neighbors inside the cluster. And we see it clearly here in the graph. You have this, which is defined as a cluster. And you see that if you're here or there or there or there, you have only possibilities to stay inside the cluster. And only when you're on this node, you have a probability to move to move outside the cluster. But even in this case, you have three possibilities to stay inside and only one to move outside. So we see that with this description, if you choose the proper communities, you will have a shorter description. So if you look how it well, here you have the example. So to describe the same random walk as before, you start with 111 to say that you start in this cluster. And then you say that you start in node 0000, so this one. Then you just have to say that you move to node 11, so this one, then to node 01, then to move to node 101, and so on and so forth. Until at this point, you have to say that you're changing community. So this time you have to add the description of the community you want to move to, and then the description of the node that you're on, and so on and so forth. And yes, in practice, you can observe that the number of bits required to encode it with this description is shorter than this one. Okay. So the numbers are a little bit strange here because you're using Huffman coding, which will give shortest code to frequent items. And if you have a high degree, you know that you will be a more frequent item in a random walk because you have more chance to be reached by a random walk. And also it's a prefix-free coding in which to optimize, you don't need to have a fixed length width. So this is just some techniques to obtain shortest descriptions, but it's not that important. What is important is the general idea. And so I won't detail it because I'm already quite late, but so the idea is really to use this information theory to try to minimize the sum of, the entropy of staying, of stepping outside of communities and the entropy of staying inside, inside clusters. And, okay, so this is, this was the informal algorithm. What is important is that to understand that we defined a new, we proposed a new definition of what is a good community. A good community is a partition such as it allows to encode a random walk efficiently. Okay, this is a definition of community like modularity. But you can use like modularity and the algorithm to optimize it. And in the recent versions, I actually use something which is close to the Louvain greedy approach because it's efficient. And one advantage of modularity is that it can recognize random network. So if you give a random network, it won't give you a random partition overfitting overfitting some random fluctuations. It will say that there is only one community. It's an advantage of over modularity. Okay, and finally, we will see another approach, which is the stochastic block model approach. So this is interesting because it's really actually a different definition of community. Until now, we have defined community as groups of nodes which are strongly connected and more weakly connected to the rest of the graph. And stochastic block models are a generalization of this, in which you allow to have blocks, and you have probabilities describing, so you have some probabilities between each pair of blocks. So for instance, here you have this network, and it's composed of four blocks, and what you will describe, you will use this this matrix here to define the probability of having an edge between each pair of blocks. So how to say it? So the red here is a part, is a block, the group of nodes, and you see that here the red this corresponds to the red one. Yellow, you have the yellow nodes, and green. And so between the red nodes and the red node, you see that you have a probability to have an edge which is of 0.5. So let's say that it's dense. You have a density of 0.5. Between the yellow and yellow, you have 0.5. So it's strongly connected. And between the yellow and red, you have only a probability of 0.1. So between yellow and red, you have few edges, and you have a probability of 0.1. Okay, so this corresponds to the community, to the modular definition of community that we have introduced before. But you see that it's more powerful because you can represent something different. For instance, you can represent this kind of core periphery organization in which there is a core in the middle, so you have a very strong probability of edge between red and red. I cannot read it, but you have some high values here and there. So it means that there is a not so low probability between the communities outside to be linked to the center. So this is larger than 0.1. And then between all the groups which are at the periphery, you have a low probability. Okay. And you can find actually any kind of structure like this. So this one is disassortative. So this means that you have very low values on the diagonal. So the groups, among the groups, there are very few connections among nodes of the same block. But you have high values between nodes of one particular block and another particular block. Okay. So, for instance, I was giving before the example of the sentimental network in which maybe you can find a block with men, a block of women, and you will have low you will have a low probability between men and women, not zero, but a low probability, lower than between men and women. So you could describe it as a disassociative network like this. So you could find this kind of structure. And yes, and you can have any other relation where you have a strong value, I don't know, in between these two blocks, for instance. So the problem with this is that the way it works usually is by doing some inference. So you will just, I don't have my formula here. Okay, just in the cheat sheet. Anyway, simply the solution, the idea is that the problem to solve is to find the parameters that optimize the probability to generate a graph with a random network, with a random generation of this network. So the parameters you're looking for, the parameters of the stochastic block model, are the number of blocks, the belonging of nodes, so the partition for each node to which block it belongs to, and the stochastic block matrix, which is exactly what I've shown before. The matrix telling you between each block, each pair of block, what is the density. Is the probability of observer nets between two nodes belonging to these blocks. Okay, exactly what I've shown before. And what you need to do is to do some inference of these parameters in order to maximize the probability to generate the graph that you observe according to these parameters. And so the problem with this, if you don't add a constraint, you come back to the same problem as I introduced in the beginning with graph partitioning. If you don't have any constraint, you will find a trivial solution, which is to have as many blocks as there are nodes. So you prep each node in its own community, and then you say that your stochastic block matrix here is the adjacency matrix. So this means that you have each node in its own community, and if there is an edge in the real graph, then the probability to have to generate an edge between these two communities is one. So basically, what you will, when you will generate a random network following this model, you have a probability of one to generate exactly the original graph. So very good, but without any interest. So that's why you need to add a constraint on the number of blocks. So you need to say, I want to find 10 blocks. And then I will find the values of B and E that will have the highest probability to generate this graph. And then recently, new methods were proposed. So if you want the details, you can check this paper, for instance, in which you will, so it's actually, I removed that, so this slide. So there is an information theoretic way to understand it, or Bayesian formulation. Basically, you want the probability, you're interested in the probability to generate the adjacency matrix, the graph, based on the parameters. So the so in this case, I also take into account the degree sequence, but just to simplify the partitions and the matrix or and the matrix of edges between blocks. And you consider the probability to have a given partition as a prior of your model. Okay, so you have a probability to have, what is the probability to have this partition? What is the probability to have this number of blocks? What is the probability to have this matrix of edges between blocks? And I'm using this and I'm trying to minimize some, actually, so it's an information theoretic way to describe it. You try to minimize the cost of describing the model, and to minimize the cost of describing the graph given the model. So, yeah. I think I don't have time to go into details, but we can discuss about it if you're interested. I have to stop here, but just to conclude with the stochastic block model, to sum up, so we have a convincing definition of community or blocks, because you're not limited anymore to dense blocks. You can find dense blocks and maybe some other structure in which you have dense connection between particular blocks. The problem is that existing algorithms are smaller, slower than Louvain and InfoMap. And it's also difficult sometimes to interpret what you get, what you're getting, because when you have a modularity, when you have communities found by a modularity maximization, you know that your groups are dense. It's simple to interpret. But when you have a block model, you need to look at all the probability between the blocks in order to see if you have to interpret it. So maybe I have this block A and block B, but what is their relation? What is the density inside? What is the density between them? I need to look at that in detail to understand the organization of the network. It can also say if there is if it's a random network. I give you a random network. The block inference should find that there is no community, a single block, and it also suffers from some sort of resolution. And it's actually getting very popular since the recent work by Pexoto that I introduced very briefly here, in which you are able to discover basically the number of blocks on top of the block adjacency, the block matrix. I don't have time to go through these slides, so I don't know if I do it next week or also in the experiments. Maybe you can have a look at it. But the idea is how do we compare and evaluate the quality of communities? So just to give you one example, which I talk about in the experiments, it's using the normalized mutual information to compute the similarity between two partitions. So I give you two partitions, and I want to know how similar they are. So you can use some scores such as the NMI or adjusted NMI to find the similarity between them. And just to end, I wanted to say that there are also other types of organization of networks. So what I described here today was organization of networks in blocks, organization of network in communities. But we have also seen before organization of network in core periphery that can be represented by blocks, as we have seen before, but also something which is not composed of blocks, but really a core and the periphery. There are also overlapping communities. So there is a strong literature on methods to find communities in which a node can belong to several groups. You have also communities of links. So if you try to find groups in which each edge belongs to one and only one group, and this naturally allows some nodes to have to belong to several groups. So you can think of it, for instance, in discovering that this edge, for instance, it could represent family links, while this edge would correspond to university links, for instance. And so this node belongs, both has university links and familial links with this node. You have hierarchical communities, in which nodes can, so you have a community with this node and this node, but you see that at a higher level, they also belong to some larger community. So you can describe hierarchically, but the Louvain method, for instance, was able to do that. And finally, you have nestedness, in which nodes tend to be connected to the same node as a reference, which is called kind of a parent node, and this kind of structure is common in ecological network. I have a reference to a paper of this kind in the cheat sheet if you're interested in nestedness in network. So sorry, I was a little bit fast at the end, but I will see. Maybe I will continue a little bit on this topic next time. yeah, you can tell me what you think. So here are the experiments in which you will try to find some communities and to play with the resolution limits to understand it. So as usual, you can make a short break before starting if you want.